Glory to God. Come on, jump up on your feet with us. It's going to be a great time in the presence of God. God's going to touch you and your family today. You're going to know you've been blessed. Amen. Glory to God. Lift your hands to heaven. If you're filled with the Holy Ghost, just begin to pray in those heavenly utterances today. Thank you, Lord. Paraka soturobobota sokuramomo selediando so otorababacheye yesese konoko sokurabale dirinilie la dato so urabasheke sapara kamarathiata hamoso ondole derenesia pogosko sopratane datana afse boso samarakane deretelesie keja shono rombobo mamaraki die televeri athanosi Isa taromo zeleche tagaba, vikane yerodomoso, moso otto loposa, cachera do vieda, yemoro oteriki sieno, mele di ata lebrike se catano shia, yovreze berodomoso proco mikie, mengo gomai mele dera bosola dara cachai, mezondo ora bastienes enterene shiki, zendele tirego so, proposto somarovo. Meje sheno doro vosto so cobro comaradatele. Me cobra covoro do so corrabaste sete. Father, we worship you this morning. Lord, we honor and extol you. Who is like you, Lord? There's no one. You're so good. You're so kind. You're so awesome, Father. So mighty in power. Father, you're so great. And we know, Lord, that you've ordained in this place today for your mighty power to be displayed. For any person who has walked through those doors into this room, that if there be any bondage represented in their life, that it be broken off of them forever today in Jesus' name. Father, I ask you for a tangible touch from heaven for every single person, Lord, that not a single person would leave today without a special blessing of an encounter with the Almighty God. That, Lord, you would speak to your people, that you would reveal yourself in a very real way. That the eyes of our understanding would be enlightened, that we would know the hope to which you have called us and how rich our glorious inheritance is as saints, your set apart ones. Father, we thank you for the glory of the Lord flooding this room from wall to wall and from floor to ceiling. I pray, Father, that if there be any sick bodies in this room, if there be any diseases, Father, that they be eradicated by your mighty hand in Jesus' name. May no one leave this place the same way they came. And we give you praise for it today in the mighty name of Jesus. If you're in agreement, give God a shout this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say this with me. Say, today is my day.
Is my day.
For the supernatural.
For the supernatural.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Quiet, we accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Come on. We were the beggars. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is shortly in this place, and we won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today,
and we won't be quiet.
We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is shortly. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. There is joy in this house today. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. Hallelujah. Give Him a mighty shout of praise. Thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. There is joy in this house this morning. Amen. Amen.
Rescued me, sing it out, Jesus is alive.
Hallelujah.
It is an empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day. Happy day, you washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. When I stand in that place, free at last, meeting face to face, I am yours, Jesus, you are mine. And this joy and perfect peace, earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Happy day, happy day. You washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Oh, happy day, happy day. You washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Jesus.
him a shout of praise this morning. Hallelujah.
Your presence is all I need. It's all I want and all I seek. And without it, there's no meaning. Your presence is the air I breathe, the song I sing, and the love I need. And without it, I'm not living.
come on and praise him. There will be no one like, no one beside you. You alone are worthy of all praise. There will be no
generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb, and all have gone before us, and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all power and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cry. Your name is the highest, your name
is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. Jesus, your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Hear your people sing, holy, to the King of Kings. We lift your name in praise. We lift you up, Lord. You are the only one who's worthy. You are the only one who's worthy. Yes, Lord. You will always be holy, 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 Lord. Holy, holy, Lord. Holy, holy, Lord. Just let him move. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. No one is more worthy, Lord. Hey. Oh. Grace that flows like a river, washing over me.
of heaven, love of Christ overflow in me. Thank you, Jesus. You set me free. Christ, my Savior, you rescued me. Take this life, deliver a vessel of your love. Thank you, Jesus, you set me free. Oh, thank you, Jesus, Christ my Savior, you rescued me. Thank you, Jesus. Set me free, Christ my Savior, you rescued me. Set me free, Christ my Savior. He rescued me. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just lift your hands all over this place this morning.
Thank you, Jesus.
Just let the presence of God touch you in this place today. There's nothing like His presence. There's nothing like His power. There's nobody like Him. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Sora Maria Nanzie. Ora Malienene Sierra Radio. Ora Malienene Sierra. Ora Naliere Rosie. Ieri era nocia candosie. Forra Maria. Ora Naliere. Ora maliere nasie. And I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. I worship you, O Prince of your name.
Great.
you, Lord. For your name is great and greatly to be praised. I sense in my spirit this morning that there are people in this room that God has set you free from so many things. But there's a whisper from the enemy, the adversary of your soul, that you're going to go back to them. I tell you by the authority of the name of Jesus, you are never going back. You're never going back to addiction. You're never going back to bondage. You're never going back to brokenness. You're never going back to sin. You're never going back in Jesus' name. Never going back in Jesus' name. For whom the Son sets free. And He has the power not only to set you free, but to keep you free. He has the power not only to heal you, but to keep you healthy. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now unto Him that is able to keep you from falling. You're not falling back. Because He will hold you up. Who art thou that judgest another man's servant? Yea, to his own master does he stand or fall. But God shall hold him up, for He is able to make him stand. You need to know that your God is able to keep you standing. The American church is in love with that scripture that a righteous man falls seven times. And if that's the case, the Lord can pick you up again. But you need to also know that He's capable of keeping you from falling in the first place. Hallelujah. So you're not going back. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And here's a little tip. The devil has low self-esteem. So when he tells you stuff like that, just call him ugly and he'll run off. The devil has low self-esteem. Hallelujah. Come here. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You too. Stand right here. You come here. Stand right next to her. Hallelujah. Two for one deal. Lift your hands to heaven. Hallelujah. Father, let a fresh touch of your anointing come over the top of these two mighty women of God. Let the eyes of their spirit see clearly that their best days are ahead of them. Hallelujah. Fire in Jesus' name. There it is. Right through you, from the top of your head to the soles of your feet. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Come here, Daisy. Come here, Daisy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Ushers, you might want to help her. She's wobbly. Hallelujah. In this church, weebles wobble and they do fall down. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God is able to make her stand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's a mighty God. Fresh touch from heaven, Lord. Fresh touch from heaven, Lord. There it is. Fire in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, give the Lord praise in this place today. Say this with me today. Say, He's a mighty God.
He's a mighty God.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. It's like the echoes of the halls of heaven right there. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You like that one? I'll be here all week. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lift your hands one more time. Father, we bless you this morning. It's so awesome to gather into your mighty presence. There's never been anyone like you. And Lord, you created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. And it wasn't even difficult. And if you created all that in 6 days, how long does it take for you to solve our problems? It won't take 5 minutes. So the rest of this 3-hour service will just be a celebration. Hallelujah. Of how good you are. We'll never get tired of praising you, which is why we're going to enjoy heaven. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Come on, give the Lord a shout of praise. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. And you may be seated in the presence of God this morning. Hallelujah. Would you give our worship team a hand who did a mighty job? Hallelujah. Did a great job. I'm so grateful for them. And our, when I say worship team, by the way, I mean our sound team too. They work together. And we're so grateful for them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We put our sound team in the back because they're so good looking. They make me feel bad about myself. So we put them back there. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. How many just sense the presence of God in here this morning? 3 of you. That's wonderful. Come on, how many sense the presence of God in here this morning? Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Now somebody says, why are they laughing? Don't let that bother you. Happy are the people whose God is the Lord. Amen. Happy are the people whose God is the Lord. Listen, Jesus makes you happy. Somebody said, where does it say that in the Bible? I'm glad you asked. John chapter 16. Hitherto have you asked nothing in my name. Ask that you may be full, that you may receive, that your joy may be full. Whose joy? Whose joy? Amen. Now, let me qualify that statement. The end of all being is not the happiness of man. And that's where people make a mistake. The end of all being is not the happiness of man. The end of all being is the glory of God. But your joy is the byproduct of glorifying God. When you glorify God, His power comes and touches you, and your very being responds with joy. Can you say amen? Because we don't serve a God who has eyes but cannot see, and ears but cannot hear, a hand but cannot stretch forth to save, feet but cannot go. We serve the living God. So when you begin to worship Him, He doesn't stand stiff like a statue. He responds. He reciprocates with His presence. Can you say amen? If you came up in on a Sunday morning to hug me, hey, Pastor Michael, you hug me and I stand there. You'd be like, well, I don't think Pastor Michael likes me very much. No, when you worship the Lord, He reciprocates with His presence. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Well, I didn't tell her I was going to do this, but I want Sister Bobby to come up. Because on Wednesday night, God did something so powerful. And don't give me that look. And I'll tell my side of it, and then she can tell her side of it. I saw the presence of the Lord come on her and her amazing sons, and I called them forward. They were over here, had them, saw it on the inside, so I did what I saw on the inside. I had them join hands, and I don't get to do this often, but I got to do it on Wednesday. And I mentioned the transference of the anointing, that the anointing is transferable. And just like electricity in the natural, that there are things that conduct electricity, in the spirit, there are things that conduct the anointing. And one of them is hunger, when you're desiring to receive from God. Amen. Likewise, there are things that, you know, are not conductive to the anointing. But the three of them were hungry. I could see God touching them. So I had them join hands, and I went over to this side. It was Jay, Corey, Bobby, and I went over. They had their hands lifted. And I said, I'm going to touch Jay's hand, and the anointing's going to go through Jay, touch Corey, and then hit Bobby. And so that's what I did. All I did is just tap Jay's hand. And he went out, and then Corey went out, and then Sister Bobby went out. But the difference between electricity and the natural and the anointing is the anointing gets stronger as it goes. And so as Bobby put it on Thursday night discipleship, she got the worst of it. I would say she got the best of it, but, you know. And she was out for the rest of the service. And I'll let her tell her side. Come here. Come over here.
Hi, guys. So, like he explained, can I see this? Let me see. like he explained, he had called us out, and then my eyes were closed. I didn't even know at what point that it came through, but it hit me, and I was like on the floor. And normally, I mean, I've been hit with the joy of the Lord, but this time it was so different. It was like being tased. And the more I try to keep it down, the more it would like come out. And so, like he said, I heard my voice like laughing, but I myself was like in my head like shut up, and then it kept. It kept going, but and so I just remember places of like remembering things, and then not, and then the Lord just was given revelation. But anyways, I don't know how I got home. I drove home, and I needed help to the bathroom. That's another thing. But anyways, thank you, Sherry. But it has. Just truly transformed our family, and so I just want to thank you.
I didn't do anything. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Come on, give the Lord praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This thing's real. This thing's real. Amen. People have said, you hypnotize them. I don't know the first thing about hypnotizing. I just tap their head. That's all I do. My job is very easy. Amen. But it's real. The presence of God is real. All the doubts are settled. And I know it's real. Hallelujah. Amen. And I'll tell you, the way she got hit on Wednesday, everybody needs a touch like that. Everybody needs a touch like that. And she said something about it on Thursday at discipleship. She said it wasn't painful, but it was so intense. She said, I felt like I was going to come out of my skin. Well, yeah, because what's happening is you're, at that moment, you are discerning the line between soul and spirit. Between spirit and body, there's a separation between these things. What you see in the mirror is not the real you. It's just a temporary house that your spirit lives in. And one day you'll get a glorified house that doesn't age. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. My pastor says all the time, you know, people ask, why doesn't God do it all at once? You couldn't handle it. If he did it all at once, you'd be seeing him face to face. You'd go to heaven. Amen. Hallelujah. So he does it little bits at a time, but sometimes those little bits are so strong, you realize why he doesn't do it all at once. Amen. The night I got hit with a fire, January 10th, 2009, when I laid down to bed that night, which by the time I did, it was hours later, my hands still shaking, my whole body still trembling under this power. Amen. And I got addicted to it, so I decided to do it forever. Hallelujah. And be under this anointing forever. Hallelujah. God wants to touch you and your family in a real way, in a powerful way, in a mighty way. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. And there's always more. Moses had the burning bush, but then he had Mount Sinai, where he was in the glory of God for 40 days and 40 nights. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Abraham had God appear to him in Genesis 12, but then he saw the furnace walking through the pieces of the sacrifice in Genesis 17. There's always more. There's always more. So whatever you've encountered and experienced from God's mighty presence up to this point, that's wonderful. But I'm telling you, God's not done yet. There's more. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. How many came to receive more this morning? Come on, give the Lord praise one more time in this place. Hallelujah. 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 Well, say this with me. Say, God's not done with me. That's why I'm still breathing. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'll tell you, one of the biggest problems in the American church right now is that people are in a hurry in the presence of God. Amen. Don't be in a hurry. Ladies, if you let a guy take you out on a date, and the whole time on the date it seemed like he was in a hurry, you'd be like, you can just go if you want. You don't want to be here. Amen. And so people treat church service like it's a drive-thru. Man, this is fine dining. Amen. When you go to like a nice restaurant, like nicer than Chili's, when I asked Pastor Mariah out on our first date, I was talking to somebody and I was like, I want to take her somewhere nice. And the person I was talking to was like, take her to Chili's, man. And I went to laugh. And then I realized that was nice to them and I felt bad. So I was all, amen, you know. Amen. Nice is a relative term, you know. But when you go like fine dining, you're going to be there a while. You don't have time for dinner and a movie. Dinner takes a while. Amen. Well, the Bible says that God has prepared a banquet table before you in the presence of your enemies. And so when you come into his house or his hotel, take your time. That's why I preach so many times in one service. It's the first course, and then the second course, and then the third course. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Somebody says, what part of the service are we in? The main part. We're in the main part of the service. Hallelujah. Now, God prepares a banquet table before you. Don't pick and choose He prepared all of it for you. Well, I'll have this, but I don't really want that. No. It's all delicious, I'm telling you. It's all wonderful. If it's being served, I'm telling you, it's good. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. You know, people before they got saved would get high on cocaine. Now they get high on religion. They get all religious. Don't get religious. Amen. Amen. I'm telling you, the presence of God is better than anything you tasted in the world. The anointing of the Holy Ghost is better than anything you tasted in the world. Far better. Far better. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Come on, give the Lord praise one more time this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, don't unplug. Stay plugged in, because I don't want to have to get the anointing stirred back up again. I'd rather just step into the flow. Stay plugged in. But welcome Pastor Regina as she comes to give you the holy anointed announcements. Hallelujah. I love you.
Amen. Good morning. I think last time I wore this jacket, he wore that jacket. So I think next time I wear it, I'm going to text him and say, don't wear the tan jacket. We're not matching on purpose. Amen. Well, good morning. Hallelujah. Good to see your beautiful faces. Hallelujah. Well, I'll tell you what. Last Sunday, we had an incredible outreach. Amen. That was amazing. Phenomenal. We were so blessed. I mean, we filled up the place, which was, I think it's about 450 people we can fit in there. That doesn't count all of the volunteers, which, by the way, we had 72 volunteers that day. Amen. And we gave away so many cool things, gift cards for school clothes primarily is what we gave away. And then all the kids got a backpack when they left. And we had, at the altar, we had 281 people, hallelujah, answer the altar call. Pastor Michael preached an incredible message about it's not too late, get on the ark, amen. And then, if you don't know it, we have our Secret Service soul winners that hang out by the door. So if people get nervous when Pastor Michael's preaching and they get up and leave, our Secret Service soul winners catch them as they're going out the door and still win them to the Lord. Amen? Amen. So a total of 325 people gave their hearts to the Lord last Sunday. And you guys are an incredible group of people. You come, you put your whole heart into it. You're all happy. You welcome our guests as they come. I mean, it's just thank you to all of you that labor so hard. Show up early, 8 o'clock in the morning. Stay late. You're all a blessing, and we're grateful for it. Amen? Amen. So the souls that were won go to all of our accounts that were there. Amen? Because we're a part of it. Glory to God. And then yesterday, we did a second backpack giveaway to the people that we had to turn away. Even though all of our advertisements said how many people, you know, how many backpacks we had a lot of people show up. So we had flyers ready to give out to them. And we had an additional, about 100 people show up yesterday. We had an additional 85 people won to the Lord as they came to pick out backpacks. Amen. So it was awesome. It was awesome. It was an awesome day yesterday. Once again, we had plenty of volunteers, and it just was pretty incredible. So, if you are a first-time visitor to Truth and Triumph, please raise your hand. We do have a gift for you. Welcome. So, right outside these double doors, hallelujah, welcome them. We have our visitor table, and if you are a first, second, or third-time visitor, please stop by the table. We have a free gift for you. Amen? Very important, and we want to know who you are. All right. And then also, if any time you come to church here when we're, as we are in the hotel of the Lord, you do not have to pay for parking. Amen? So what they do is when you leave, they put the arm up when about 1:30-ish, 1:15, they put the arm up, and that way you can just drive on through. If you happen to linger around here and when you go through, the arm is down, there's a call button. You push that call button, you just say, I'm with Truth and Triumph, and they'll lift it for you. You don't have to pay for parking. We pay for the parking for you. Amen? Amen. We don't want to you to have to come to church and like, oh my God, I got to fork out, you know, $12 to pay for parking. No, we pay it for you. It's all taken care of. All right? Now, also this coming Saturday, say this Saturday, is Soul Winning Saturday. All right? And believe it or not, we're doing another backpack giveaway. So what we're going to do is the same thing. As the people come to get their backpacks, we're going to have our soul winners catch them as they're walking to their cars and lead them to the Lord. So it's going to be fruit for the picking, right? Fruit right off the tree. So this is a good time for those of you who haven't come yet. Because it's not the same as like having to knock on a door or having to run after people in the Walmart parking lot. You're actually going to be able to just catch, you know, as they're walking out the door with their backpacks. So please come out and help us. And we'll train you how to win souls using the gospel soul winning script. So that's this Saturday from 11 to 2 o'clock at the church office. Amen? Amen. All right. And then also for soul winning, every Wednesday, 5 o'clock in the church parking lot, Brother Miguel takes out a team, and they go soul winning for an hour and a half. So every Wednesday, 5 p.m., you meet them here. They go soul winning. I think last Wednesday, they led 35 people to the Lord in an hour and a half. Amen. And then you get back here at 6:30, just in time for church, for service, okay, for our Wednesday night service. So we give you plenty of opportunity to be a soul winner. Amen. All right, and then also this coming Friday, August 11th, is Youth Night, amen, from 7 to 10 p.m., and that is ages 12 to 19, and they have a good time, I know that, and I know they always eat pizza. I do see that every time we order pizza for them, but that's a good thing because kids never get tired of pizza, but Pastor Michael preaches a powerful message. The kids get under the anointing, amen. And they get addicted to the anointing so that they don't want anything else that the world has to offer. Amen? Amen. And then every Thursday night, we have Discipleship Initiative. Amen. 7 o'clock. And that's at our church office. And if you haven't come out, come out. Come be a part. Amen? Come be a part of the family. It's very important. You know, all of these things that we do are for all of our benefits. Amen? Because we need to continually hear the word being preached. Because the word being preached builds faith in our heart. Amen? And faith in your heart, then faith starts coming out of your mouth. When faith comes out of your mouth, that's when you start getting miracles in your life. Amen? So it's very important. And also your mind gets renewed. So you're no longer troubled in your thinking, but then you also begin to think like God thinks. Amen? So when sicknesses, when things try to come your way that Jesus paid the price for on the cross, when your mind is renewed, you're like, wait a minute, that's not mine. That's not for me. Jesus took care of that. Amen? So all these things are for all of our benefit so that we can grow. Amen? And have the victory that was paid for by Jesus for us. Glory to God. Amen. And then also every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, we have prayer at noon, amen, for 1 hour at the church office. So come on out, pray with us. It's only an hour. We don't keep you any longer than that. Don't be afraid if you feel like you're not an experienced prayer, that's okay. Just come on out and pray with us anyway, amen? All right, and then every Wednesday and Friday, Pastor Michael has his live broadcast on Facebook and YouTube. It's at 10 a.m. And if you're not able to watch the live broadcast, you can go back later and watch the recording. Amen. And I tell you what, those teachings are also so powerful, so word-packed, all with the intention to help us, to benefit us so that we can grow. Amen. And have victory in our lives. And I think that's it. Amen. Thank you very much.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Mommy. Hallelujah. That's my mom. She works for me now. But somehow she still tells me what to do, so now she just gets paid to tell me what to do. It's fantastic. Amen. I'll be like, I think that, no, we're doing this. Okay. Praise the Lord. It's because I'm scared of her. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. But thankfully she has little legs, so I can get away from her if I need to. Because she has to take twice as many steps as I do to go the same distance. Amen. Hallelujah. Security, keep an eye on her this morning, please. Okay. Praise the Lord. How many are happy to be here this morning? Glory to God. I'm happy to see you. Amen. Praise the Lord. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles before we receive this morning's tithes and offerings to the book of Romans, if you would, please. And I'm going to go to probably a familiar chapter, but I want to bring some things up to you out of this chapter. My mom mentioned it just a moment ago, but the Bible says, we're going to Romans chapter 10, but the Bible says in Romans chapter 12, not to be conformed to this world, but to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. How many know that? Amen. And so the Word of God is intended to help you renew your mind so that you don't think like you used to think and so that you don't see things from the same carnal or fleshly perspective that you used to see things through. Amen. The Bible says in James chapter 3 that sensual wisdom, in other words, wisdom that is based on the senses, wisdom based on what you can see, wisdom based on what you can hear, wisdom based on what you can feel, the Bible says that that wisdom is actually demonic. Why is that? Because the enemy can easily manipulate what you see, what you hear, and what you feel in order to think the way he wants you to think. There is one way and one way only that you begin to think God's way, and it's by the Word. Can you say amen? The Bible says that the Word lives and abides forever. The Bible says that the Word of God will endure forever. It says that all flesh is as grass, and the glory of man is like the flower of the field. Well, the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of the Lord shall endure forever. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. And so this word, then the Bible says that this word is also forever settled in heaven. In God's mind, this is settled. He's not going back on it. And if you're looking to receive anything from God, you've got to be in line with this right here. Because God watches only over one thing to perform it, and that's his word. Can you say amen? Where many people have missed it with God, it's not that God's not merciful or compassionate. There's no way you could read this book and come to the conclusion that God isn't merciful or compassionate. But where many people have missed it is that they think that God is moved by their hardship. He is not. He is moved only by faith. Amen. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. And so what this word does is not only does it renew our mind, but faith comes by and hearing by? Can you say amen? Now that's the only way faith comes. It's the one and only way that faith comes. I need you to know this also today. God does not teach by destruction. God only teaches by instruction. God does not teach by destruction. God only teaches by instruction. Now, that doesn't mean you can't learn from something you've gone through, but it means that you could have avoided the hardship that came along with what you experienced if you would have known ahead of time what God's word says. My people are destroyed for a lack. Look at you Bible scholars. Y'all read your Bibles. Amen. My people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. It does not say my people are destroyed because I'm trying to teach them a lesson. If you would have learned ahead of time. Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 19 says, if you be willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. The New Living Translation says, if you would only let me help you. Man, I'm telling you, as a parent of a 5-year-old little girl who knows everything and has never been in a situation where she doesn't know what to do, the number of times where she goes to do something on her own And I tell her, baby, let me help you. No, I'm going to do it on my own. I'm going to do it by myself. And I'm watching her, and I'm like, things would be so much easier if you would just let me help you. I'm telling you, that's in many cases, that's the way the Lord looks at what's going on with us. So God does not teach by destruction. That doesn't mean you can't learn something, but that's not the way God intended for you to learn. And God does not introduce destruction because you refuse to learn. Any hardship that you experienced was because my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. It was ignorance. But I've got good news for you. God wrote down his wisdom. God wrote down his truth in perpetuity. It is always available in the pages of the scripture so that you and I can always go back to it and find out what God's word has to say and get ourselves in line. Can you say amen? The Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. How much scripture? So you can't pick a verse out and say, well, it didn't mean that. Can't pick a verse out and say, well, that verse wasn't inspired. You know, people get mad at us Pentecostals because we quote 3 John 2, beloved, I desire above all that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. And people try to say, well, that's not, God's not really saying he wants you to prosper and be in health. It was just a common greeting of the day. Well, the Holy Spirit allowed John to write it down in the scripture. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. So if God didn't want us to prosper and be in health, then the Holy Spirit would have stopped John from writing the common greeting of the day. By the way, that's also nonsense that it was a common greeting of the day. No, it wasn't. Nobody went up to each other and said, I want you to prosper and be in health even as your soul prospers. Nobody did that. You know what the common greeting of the day was? Hi. That was the common greeting of the day. Don't listen to dumb people. Amen. Hallelujah. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man or woman of God may be perfected, thoroughly furnished unto every good work. So when the Bible says in Psalm 23, he leads me on the paths of righteousness for his name's sake, how does he lead me on those paths? Is it some arbitrary sovereignty that God is working behind the scenes and everything's just happening exactly how he wants? No. How does he lead me on the paths of righteousness? The word of God is profitable for instruction in righteousness. The way he leads you on the paths of righteousness is through the pages of this book. That's why God told Joshua, this book of the law shall not depart from your lips, but you shall meditate day and night in it, and be careful, be aware, be watchful to observe and to do all that is written therein, for then you will make your way prosperous and you will have good success. Notice it didn't say, I will make your way prosperous. That's God talking to Joshua. Notice God didn't say, I will make your way prosperous. He said, you will make your way prosperous. Does that mean we should get the glory? No. God has already paved out the path of prosperity and success. You choose whether you're going to walk on it or not. And the way you choose to walk on it or not is by doing what this says right here. Can you say amen? Amen. Say this morning. Say, I'm a doer of the word, not just a hearer. Amen. The Bible says those who are hearers only, they deceive themselves. How many have ever met somebody who believes their own lies? You don't have to hesitate. Is that person in this room? You don't want to raise your hand? How many of you have met somebody who believes their own lies? And you listen to them and you're like, what? Like, you're crazy. You can't even fathom the sociopathic levels it takes for them to believe the things that they're saying. And they believe them. Self-deception is the worst kind of deception. Because who are you going to trust more than yourself? So if you're deceiving your own self, that's the worst kind of deception. Well, the Bible says those who hear the word but don't do it, they deceive themselves. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. That's the problem with offense. Offense is self-deception. Because you tell yourself, I'm allowed to feel this way. I'm allowed to think like this. I'm allowed to hold grudges. I'm allowed to be bitter. Can you say amen? And to be offended is to not be a doer of the word. Because the Bible says, all those who love his law have great peace, and nothing shall offend them. Amen. All those who love his law have great peace, and nothing shall offend them. That has nothing to do with the tithe or offering, but I thought I'd say it. All right. Praise the Lord. But what I am here to tell you today is that as a believer, you have to allow the word of God to renew your mind when it comes to needs. If you as a believer continue to look at your needs the same way you did before you got born again, it is going to dictate how much of the blessing of God you're capable of walking in this life. And I'm sure there are going to be scores of believers that stand before God on the day of judgment, and the Lord is going to have to pull back a curtain and show them all of the things that he had for them, all of the blessings that he wanted to pour out on their life, but they missed it because they never renewed their mind concerning what the Word of God has to say about finances. Can you say amen? So I want you to understand this today. I don't take the time that I take on Sundays to preach on giving because I'm trying to cheerlead an offering out of you. If anything, this kind of ministering on giving is what causes people to not give. If I was really just trying to get more money out of people's pockets, I would put up pictures of malnourished children from third world countries and beg you to give so that little Bill can eat, you know. Or we can fix his cleft lip or something. But what I am telling you today is that the Word of God has a lot to say about finances. And what the Word of God has to say about finances is very different than what the world has told you about finances. Can you say amen? How many have heard the book Rich Dad, Poor Dad? Very successful businessman wrote a book called Rich Dad, Poor Dad. I'm guessing, since only a few hands went up, I'm guessing many of you haven't heard of it, so I'll tell you about it. Very successful businessman wrote a book called Rich Dad, Poor Dad. And the whole premise of the book was that he was talking about the difference of what he learned about finances from his biological father, who was a very poor man, and then his mentor in business, who was a very wealthy man. The whole book is really just a dividing line between how his impoverished father saw finances and then how his very wealthy mentor saw finances, and they were exactly the opposite. Now, not everything that the rich businessman had to say about finances was biblical, but ultimately what the man was really telling us in his book is that he renewed his mind to lose the mindset that his biological impoverished father had taught him, and he renewed his mind to look at finances the way his wealthy mentor had taught him. Well, I'm here to tell you today that God has a better perspective on finances than any wealthy businessman, and if you'll allow his word to renew your mind and you'll look at them through the lens of the scripture, you'll find yourself walking in greater wealth than you could ever imagine. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So with that being said, have you found Romans chapter 10? If you haven't found it by now, give up. Amen. Romans chapter 10. Hallelujah. And verse 5. Say amen when you're there. Amen. For Moses describes the righteousness which is of the law, that the man which does those things shall live by them. It's a righteousness that's dependent on works. Verse 6, but the righteousness which comes through faith speaks on this wise. In other words, the righteousness which comes from believing God talks like this. Now, let me stop there for a moment. How many here are born again? That's a great number of hands. Praise the Lord. If you're born again, then the Bible says you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And the Bible says, by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. So the righteousness that you received was a gift. It was not a righteousness that you earned. However, now that you've been brought into the righteousness which came through faith, you need to find out how that righteousness talks. Amen. Verse 6 here says, the righteousness which is of faith talks like this. Why is that important? Because the way you talk is an indication of the way you think. And the Bible says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. And you know how somebody thinks in their heart, because out of the abundance of the mouth. So when you recognize that words are leaving your mouth contrary to the righteousness of faith, then that's where the work needs to be done. That's where we take the Word of God, the tool of the Word of God, and we start going to work. Can you say amen? But the righteousness which is of faith talks like this. Say not. So that's important. The righteousness which is of faith, there's things it shouldn't say. If you're talking from the righteousness, from the right standing, that's what righteousness is, from the right standing with God that you have, there are things you will say and there are things you should not say. Amen. Can you say amen? Amen? But the righteousness which is of faith talks like this. Say not in your heart, who shall ascend into heaven? That is to bring Christ down from above. Verse 7. Or who shall ascend into the deep? That is to bring Christ up from the dead again. But what does it say? The Word, which is Christ, Christ is the Word made flesh, the Word is near to thee, even in your mouth and in your heart. This is the word of faith which we preach. Now let's boil down these two things that the Bible says here that the righteousness which comes from believing God does not say. The righteousness of faith, the right standing with God that comes from believing God, that righteousness does not say, who shall ascend into heaven to bring Christ down? Why? He already came down. Oh boy, you guys didn't know that. Okay, if you didn't know, Jesus came down from heaven and was incarnated in human flesh. How many knew that? All right, okay, good. Whew, I was a little worried. All right. The righteousness which is of faith does not say, who shall bring Christ down for me? The righteousness which is of faith does not say, who shall bring Christ up from the dead for me? Why? Because it's already happened. It's already done. Say it's already done. So what does the righteousness, the right standing with God that comes from believing God, what does that righteousness say? That righteousness says the word is very near to me. In other words, I have what I need. I am here to tell you this morning that when you begin to look at finances through the righteousness which comes from believing God, you will not view your finances by what you need. You will view your finances by what you have. And Jesus exemplified that for us. In John chapter 6, I won't turn there for sake of time this morning, but in John chapter 6, we get John's account of the feeding of the 5,000. How many have heard that story before? Where there were, the Bible says, 5,000 men, not including women and children. The reason they didn't count women and children is because there were way more of them. It was easier to count the men because there were less of them. Because if you've ever been to any church service, this morning would even suffice to prove it. If you've been to any church service ever, there's always more women and children than there are men. Amen. Although, I'm thankful for how many men we got in here this morning. Mighty men of God in this room. Amen. But there were 5,000 men, not counting women and children. So that would mean that there were probably somewhere around 20 to 25,000 people that day. And the disciples were looking at the crowd based on need. They were not looking through the lens of righteousness which comes from believing God. So the disciples looked at the crowd based on need, and they said, send them away. We don't have enough to feed them. Many of you have experienced something like that. When you were growing up, your friend was over playing video games, and your mom said, honey, can you come into the kitchen for a minute? And she sounded all nice. And then when you got in the kitchen, she said, send your little friend home. I don't have enough food for him. You tell him to go home and let his own mother cook for him. You're laughing because it's true. And then she walks into the living room where you were playing video games. Johnny, is your mommy home yet, honey? Is she going to cook something for you? She's all nice now. Anyway. Praise the Lord. So the disciples said, I know, I'm in trouble. The disciples said, send them away, they said, because we don't have enough. We don't have enough to feed all these people. Jesus said, now the disciples looked at their need. Jesus looked at the need of the people. Jesus said, if we send them away, they're going to faint on the way to the city. He cared for people. Isn't he awesome? I'm so glad Jesus doesn't want me to faint from hunger. Jesus wants me to eat. Amen. I've taken hold of that promise. Hallelujah. Jesus said, no. If we send them away now, they're going to faint before they even get to town. And then he said this, you give them something to eat. What is he telling them? He's telling them, say not, I don't have enough. Somebody bring me what I need. He's saying, say, I have everything I need. You give them something to eat. Andrew says, well, we have 300 denarii. But what is that among so many people? Now, the Bible says that a denarii is a day's wage. So just by buying power, if we were to equate the two, a day, 300 denarii, if a denarii is a day's wage, 300 denarii would basically be a year's salary. Well, the average year's salary in America right now is $56,000. So they weren't broke. But $56,000 is not going to pay for 25,000 people to eat. Amen. And you'll be broke afterwards. Right. So they said, we have 300 denarii, but what is that among so many people? Then Philip comes along. I found this boy, and I beat him up and took his 5 loaves and 2 fish. I always wonder how they got the boy to agree to it. I wonder if they bullied him into it. But anyway, there's a lad here, they said. He didn't beat him up. But there's a lad here, they said. There's a boy with 5 loaves and 2 fish. Jesus said, give it to me. Is 5 loaves and 2 fish enough to feed 25,000 people? But see, this is how Jesus thinks. Jesus doesn't think need-minded. Jesus thinks seed-minded. And contained within the seed is the provision that will produce all that you need. Can you say amen? As the old saying goes, you can count the seeds in an apple, but you can't count the apples in a seed, because that thing just keeps producing. It doesn't stop. So now what did Jesus do? Jesus was looking at the 5 loaves and 2 fish, not from a need mindset, but that the 5 loaves and 2 fish was enough because of what rested on Jesus. Now, if righteousness is right standing with God, let me ask you a question. Was Jesus in right standing with his Father? He sure was. Man, I remember, you need to understand this morning. I remember growing up in church, and whenever anybody prayed, they always took a somber posture. And they looked so sad. Oh God, we're nothing but worms in thy holy sight. I heard one preacher one time, he was on a panel with a bunch of other preachers, and they were doing a Q&A with the crowd. And somebody asked, there was an anonymous, but they were the question was, do you think that the curse that came on Adam and Eve in the garden was too harsh of a punishment for what Adam and Eve did? Now, I don't. I don't think that at all. But what this preacher's response was, this I had a problem with. This preacher said, how dare you ask that question when this creature from the dirt defied the living God? Well, now Adam did defy the living God. But if you think that God only looked at Adam as a creature from the dirt, God had counsel with himself, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and said, let us make man in our image. Humanity was the only creature that God didn't just speak into being, but he formed him with his very hands from the dust of the earth. The only thing created that God breathed out the life from himself into this very being. Every creature breathes, but only we are capable of breathing the breath of life. If you think Adam was just a creature from the dirt, you haven't read your Bible. I don't care how many THDs and PhDs you have. You have 32 degrees and you're still frozen. Amen. Get it? 32 degrees. Okay. Hallelujah. Amen. There we go. It takes a minute sometimes, but we're getting there. Praise the Lord. So here's what I'm asking you today. Was Jesus in right standing with his Father? Yes, he was. By Jesus' sacrifice, are you in right standing with your Father? You sure are. In fact, not only are you in right standing, you're in the same degree of right standing that Jesus was. Because he made him who knew no sin to be made sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. Same righteousness in him. So the same right standing, the same favorable perspective that the Father had on Jesus, he has on you. I believe that's one of the things that hinders people from giving the way they want to give. Is they're not sure that God will favor them the way they need him to. I want you to know, you have God's favor. Hey, listen. God not only loves you, he likes you. He likes you. He likes me more than you, but he likes you. He's been so good to me, it's hard not to feel that way. But as Evangelist Jonathan said, I can't prove it biblically. So, but it sure feels, he's been so good to me. So now, like I said, growing up, you know, just this downtrodden religious posture where they think that God will like your prayer more if you self-denigrate. They'll like your prayer more if you just tear yourself down. God does not get greater glory by you tearing yourself down. Can you say amen? Amen. But the Bible says that Jesus in John chapter 6, when he said, give me the loaves and fish, the Bible says he looked up. What if I told you that this morning that the biblical posture for prayer is to look up? Lift your eyes unto the hills, from whence comes your help. Your help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Can you say amen? Now, if you don't think you're in right standing, then you hide your countenance. Then you're like the man that was in the temple that beat his chest and wouldn't even look up into heaven and said, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. And all of us have had to pray that prayer at one time, but since we've received the Lord's mercy, we can now look up because I'm in right standing with God, not because of anything I've done, but because of what he did. So it's not righteousness that's based on what you've done, but the righteousness, the right standing with God that comes from believing God talks like this. It does not talk about what it doesn't have. It does not talk about need. It talks about what it does have. Your word is very near to me, in my mouth, in my heart. And the Bible expounds on that in Deuteronomy chapter 30, which is the Old Testament scripture that this is quoting, where it says that I may hear it and do it. That when the word is received, the righteousness which is of faith. What is faith? Faith is believing what God said. So when you find what the word of God has to say about any subject, the righteousness of faith hears it and does it. Can you say amen? Amen? Your word is very near to me, in my mouth and in my heart. So when Jesus was handed that 5 loaves and 2 fish, in the natural, nobody would have calculated those 5 loaves and 2 fish and said, that's enough for 25,000 people. But in Jesus' view, who looked at it through the righteousness which is of faith, Jesus said, this is enough. And the Bible says that he looked up to heaven, and then the Bible says that he blessed the loaves and fish. Now again, you have to see things through the Bible perspective. Because if you think a blessing, the summary of the blessing is finding 20 bucks on the ground. You pick up 20 bucks, oh, I'm blessed. I mean, that's great, but that's not what the blessing is. If you think the blessing is getting an extra discount at the store because somebody thought you were cute, I mean, that's great, but that's not the blessing. What is the blessing? We've talked about this. Both in the Hebrew and the Greek, the word blessing means happy. But that still doesn't define what the blessing is. But thankfully, God defines the blessing for us. And in Genesis chapter 1, in verse 27, God tells us what the blessing is. The Bible says that after God had formed man out of the dust of the earth, breathed the breath of life into him, that God blessed him, saying. In other words, what he said was the blessing. What did he say? Be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth, take dominion over it, and subdue it. Now, what did Jesus do with the 5 loaves and 2 fish? He blessed them. What does that mean? It means he imparted to them the ability. I know the fish were dead, and loaves are not living entities. But he imparted to these inanimate objects the ability to be fruitful and to multiply, to replenish the people. He took dominion over the laws of physics so that somehow bread and fish was materializing out of nowhere. Can you see that? That's what he did. He imparted the spiritual ability onto those 5 loaves and 2 fish to be more than enough for 25,000 people. Can you say amen? And without going into further detail, by the time everybody had eaten and was full, you Bible scholars, how many baskets were taken up afterwards? 12. And the Bible says full baskets. 12 baskets left over after 25,000 people had eaten. Can you say amen? How is that possible? Because Jesus didn't look based on need. He looked based on seed. The 5 loaves and the 2 fish, nobody would have argued would have been enough to feed 25,000 people. But when you have the blessing resting on you, then when that seed is released, it is empowered. It's given the godly ability to all of a sudden become more than enough, to all of a sudden become fruitful. You need to understand something today. When you release whatever God tells you to give this morning, there is a blessing on your life that gets imparted to the seed of obedience. That's the key, the seed of obedience. But when you release that seed, it produces, when it wasn't enough, it produces what becomes more than enough. I need you to know this today. God's desire for you is to live perpetually in the place of more than enough. Say that today. God desires for me to live perpetually in the place of more than enough. And seed time and harvest is how he makes it happen. Seed time and harvest. No, listen. No, that's why he called it seed. He had to relate it to something that we could understand in the natural. No farmer would look at a seed and say, oh, all I have is a seed. A farmer would look at a seed and say, thank God I have what it takes to produce what I don't have. Can you say amen? And then you also need to understand this. Contained in every harvest is more seed to be planted. Now that's where many people miss it. They sow a seed, they get a harvest, but they consume the whole harvest. Something in that harvest was a seed that was supposed to be planted for you to continue to increase. If you keep eating the whole thing, and you eat what was supposed to be sown, you're going to lose out on a future harvest. So people keep going from not enough to more than enough to not enough to more than enough, because when the harvest of more than enough comes in, they consume it all. Instead of asking the Lord, what part of this harvest is meant to be sown back in? Can you say amen? That's why people are constantly stuck in that cycle. Constantly having to bring a sacrificial offering. Constantly having to bring a sacrificial seed. And if you're in that position, God will honor it. He that sows in tears shall reap in joy. Those that go forth bearing precious seed shall doubtless come again bearing their sheaves with them. God will always honor a seed of sacrifice, a precious seed. But you don't have to live in a place where you are constantly going from not enough to more than enough to not enough to more than enough. You can live in a place where if you come to a full understanding of this process of prosperity that God has set in place, then you'll realize every time a harvest comes, there's a seed somewhere in that harvest. Now, I know they genetically modify our food now so that somehow they produce without seeds so that you and I can't grow our own gardens and produce our own food. But before those idiots started doing that, every harvest contained a seed. If you cut open an avocado and there's no seed in the middle, something's wrong. Can you say amen? And just like seed in the natural, the seeds that are contained in every harvest you get vary in size. An avocado seed is a lot bigger than an apple seed. But all you have to do is ask the Lord, what's my seed? What's my seed? And when you sow it again, you don't think need-minded, but you think seed-minded. You're in a place of constant production. Sow sparingly. Come on. Sow sparingly. Sow bountifully. Sow sporadically. Sow continuously. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Did you get something out of that this morning? Come on, give the Lord praise in this place. Hallelujah. So here's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to give you an opportunity to give today. Your tithes and your offerings, whatever else the Lord would have you to give. Take a moment right now and ask Him, Lord, what would you have me to give? And the seed of obedience is blessed to multiply. The seed of obedience is blessed to multiply. Ushers are coming down the way right now with offering envelopes. If you're making out a check, you can make your check out to Truth and Triumph. Don't make it out to me. Make it out to Truth and Triumph. You can make out, or you can give by cash today as well. If you'd like to give online, do I have somebody that can change the slide for me? If you'd like to give online, you can give by PayPal at paypal.me/truth, the letter N, Triumph. Thank you. PayPal.me/truth, the letter N, Triumph. You can give by Cash App today at $truth, the letter N, Triumph. You can give by Venmo at @truth, the letter N, Triumph. You can give by text 628-444-4136. Text the word give to that number. You'll receive a text back with a link. Tap that link, enter your card information. We'll say thank you so much. You can give by Zelle today at 951-536-1803. Don't get those two numbers mixed up. Zelle is 951-536-1803. Text to give is 628-444-4136. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord's been so good. We're already having the best year we've ever had as a ministry. God has been so gracious, so generous. We're so grateful. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Do we have any cheerful givers in the house? Yeah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Give everybody an opportunity to fill out their giving information. Thank you, Jesus. We are looking at dates right now for Yuma, and praise the Lord. And it looks like it's going to be mid to late September is when we'll be going to Yuma. Praise the Lord. I didn't want to do it too soon after the back-to-school outreach, try to give everybody a break. The Lord's already been giving me a plan on how to approach Yuma so that I don't wear our people out, because the last thing you want to do is burn out your help. Amen. And I'm so grateful for all of you. So the Lord's already given me a plan for that, which I'll go into more. And then we haven't picked a date yet, but it dawned on me and my wife about a week ago that we have a whole bunch of young adults in our church now, which is fantastic. So we're going to be doing a young adults fellowship very soon at Top Golf. If you've never been, it's awesome. You get to watch me swing at a golf ball and miss for about 3 hours. And then we'll eat. So we're going to put that information together. We'll be announcing that very soon. Probably next Sunday we'll announce that. And just got to look at the dates and prices for that. Hallelujah. It's going to be a lot of fun. Amen. Hallelujah. So, y'all ready to give this morning? Yeah. Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you today for both the gift and the giver. I thank you, Father, that what is given shall be returned back to them, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. You shall cause men to give into their pockets, you said. Father, you said you give seed to the sower and bread for eating. You multiply the seed sown and you increase the fruits of our righteousness. You cause us to be enriched in everything unto all generosity, which results in greater thanksgiving being brought to you. And so, Father, as your people sow in obedience today, I thank you that the seed of obedience is already empowered to multiply, that it's coming back into their hands, exceeding that which they released, because the harvest is always greater than the seed. We thank you, Lord, for it today, that where they are now is the smallest they'll ever be financially. In Jesus' name, that because they possess the righteousness which is of faith, the righteousness which comes from believing God, that, Lord, you said all those who put their trust in you shall never be ashamed. And we thank you, Lord, for it in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. God bless you as you give this morning.
But you are the Most High God. There is none like you. All the other gods, they are the works of men. But you are the Most High God. There is none like you, Jehovah. You are the Most High. You are the Most High God, Jehovah. You are the Most High. You are the Most High God, Jehovah. You are the Most High. You are the Most High God, Jehovah. You are the Most High. You are the Most High God. You are good and your mercy is forever. Hallelujah. You are good and your mercy is forever. Hallelujah. You are good and your mercy is forever. Hallelujah. You are good and your mercy is forever. Hallelujah. Jehovah, you are the Most High. You are the Most High God, Jehovah. You are the Most High. You are the Most High God, Jehovah. You are the Most High. You are the Most High God, Jehovah. You are the Most High. You are the Most High God. You are good and your mercy is forever. Hallelujah. You are good and your mercy is forever. Hallelujah. You are good and your mercy is forever. Hallelujah. You are good and your mercy is forever. Hallelujah. Jehovah, you are the Most High. You are the Most High God, Jehovah. You are the Most High. You are the Most High God, Jehovah. You are the Most High. You are the Most High God, Jehovah. You are the Most High. You are the Most High God.
Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Father, we bless you this morning. We thank you for the honor and opportunity to get into your word. We thank you that your word is a light unto our path and a lamp unto our feet. We thank you for the precious Holy Spirit of God, our teacher and our guide. We trust him this morning for illumination into the word which lives and abides forever. That word which transforms, that word which pierces to the dividing asunder, the soul and the spirit, the joint and the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Father, as your word goes forth to minister to your people today, that they might perceive and know that which you would have them to receive, Lord, let your anointing come alongside and do a work in the deepest parts of them, going where the knife of man cannot go, and doing a work today in Jesus' name. Set a guard over my lips, Father, and keep watch at the door of my mouth, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart would be pleasing and acceptable to you, for you are my strength and my redeemer. Make my tongue, Father, like the pen of a ready writer, that I may speak forth your word. For you said, when I speak, I'm to speak as an oracle of God. And when I minister, it's to be according to the ability that you give, that you might receive the glory through the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, to whom belongs the glory and honor, power and dominion, majesty and praise, both now and forevermore. We thank you, Lord, for it today in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Come on, give the Lord praise one more time. Come on, give him the highest praise today. Hallelujah. Amen. And give Daniel a hand, who did a great job. Amen. Hallelujah. Love that song. Thank God for our African brothers and sisters and their praise, because it's fantastic. Hallelujah. All right. Well, today I'm preaching a message called The True Signs of the Times. The True Signs of the Times. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 16, if you would, please. Matthew chapter 16. Hallelujah. Matthew chapter 16. And I want to lay out some things to you today through the scripture, and maybe debunk some false thinking, some false mindsets that came through bad teaching that has really paralyzed the body of Christ from walking in the power and the dominion that she should be. Because I don't know about you, but I grew up in church, and what I've heard most of my life is that what we should be expecting in this last hour of time is basically for everything to fall to CRAP. Basically, we're told that we should just batten down the hatches and things are going to get worse and worse, but don't worry, one day there's going to be a trumpet and the sky will split and we'll ascend up to heaven to meet Jesus in the air, and ever shall we be with the Lord. But until then, we should be expecting nothing but turmoil. I need you to understand today that that is not at all what the Bible tells us are the signs of the times. And that if you and I would get a perspective from the scripture, we would know not only what God has in store for his church, not only what God has in store for his people, but what God has in store for the world. Can you say amen? I was thinking about something particularly just the other day. If I were to quote John 3:16, which I'm about to do, many of you could quote it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever would believe in him would not perish, but would have everlasting life. Amen. And then the following verse, verse 17. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Something that I believe that many Christians don't understand is that in the same way that God sent his son not to condemn the world, but to save the world, Jesus said, as the Father has sent me, so send I you. In other words, in the same way that God sent his Father, Jesus has sent us. The same way that the Father sent Jesus, so Jesus has sent us. So how did or what did the Father send the Son to do? Jesus tells us, not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Now, I'm not telling you that any one of you is supposed to get crucified on a cross for somebody's sins. Jesus already did that. However, the message of salvation, the Bible calls it the ministry of reconciliation. That ministry rests on you and I because we are what the Bible calls the body of Christ. Now, when Jesus was here on the earth physically, he was the only body of Christ on the earth. When Jesus was here on the earth physically, he was the only one full of the Holy Spirit. When Jesus was here on the earth physically, he was the only one that had all authority and all power in heaven and in earth. But now, you and I, now that Jesus has ascended into heaven, and we have been baptized into Christ, the Bible says, and have put on Christ, now you and I are the body of Christ here on the earth. Do you understand what that means? That means that the same authority and the same dominion that Jesus walked in for the sake of the world when he was here, that same authority and dominion you and I are authorized by heaven to walk in. Can you say amen? Now let me ask you something. If that's true, and it is, let me ask you something. Were people, when Jesus showed up, were things allowed to stay the same? They certainly weren't. Was there any devil that Jesus commanded that didn't come out? Not a single one. Amen. One of them tried to make a deal one time, but that's about it. Amen. Hallelujah. And you got goofballs out there that try to use that scripture to say, oh, you see, sometimes it takes a while. No. The difference is that with these people, when they try to cast the devil out, it tells them no. But with Jesus, when he told that thing to come out, it said, I'm coming out, but can I go into the pigs? Is that okay? They were asking permission. That's called dominion. Can you say amen? And so the same authority and dominion that Jesus walked in here on the earth while he was here, that same authority and dominion has been granted to you and I. And the way Jesus summarized that for us is when he said in Matthew chapter 18, I give you the keys of the kingdom. Whatsoever, say whatsoever. Whatsoever. That's a fancy way of saying anything. Whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. In other words, whatever you decide to do, heaven will back you up. Remember when Jesus told the disciples, he said, whosoever sins you remit, they are remitted. Remember the Pharisees got all mad at Jesus because he looked at a guy and said, son, your sins are forgiven you. And the Pharisees, only God has the authority to forgive sins. But Jesus, first of all, looks at the Pharisees and said, what's easier to say? Your sins are forgiven, or rise, take up your bed and walk. But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. He looked at the paralytic. I say unto you, rise, take up your bed and walk. And the man rose, took up his bed and walked. Can you say amen? But then Jesus told the disciples, whoever sins you remit, they are remitted. Jesus said, a disciple shall not be above his master. I need you to know this today. You will never be better than Jesus. Some of y'all look like you hesitated on that. Were you trying to be better than him? It's going to be a very difficult task. You're going to fail. How many know you'll never be better than Jesus? But did you also know it that in the same passage, Jesus said, it is enough that the disciple be like his master? Can you say amen? So in the same way that Jesus did not come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved, in the same way, you and I are not here to condemn the world. You and I are here to preach the ministry of reconciliation, that every price has been paid for all of humanity to be made right with the living God. And he's given us the power and the authority to back up that message. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. So if we think then that the signs of the times, that what we should be expecting in the last hour of time is nothing more than the world falling apart and the church dwindling down to 15 people who are weeping and wailing and singing 6 hymns out of a hymn book, getting smacked around until the rapture happens, you and I are not going to understand that there's actually an authority on the inside of us as the children of God to set things right while we're here. Can you say amen? Can I tell you something? If you study world history from 33 AD when Jesus was crucified until now, the state of the world, how good things are, how bad things are, the state of the world has gone up and down. If you didn't know that, that's the case. The state of the world has gone up and down. Well, if the signs of the times were things were just going to get worse and worse and worse and worse and worse and worse until Jesus came back, then the world is not following the pattern that the Bible gave. But that's not the pattern the Bible gave. Why has the state of the earth, why has the state of the world, why has the state of the nations gone up and down over the last 2,000 years? I'll tell you why. Because it has always followed the pattern of the church. When the church is operating in authority, the world begins to improve. And when the church forsakes or neglects their authority, the world begins to fall. The Bible says, when the righteous rule, the city rejoices. But when the wicked rule, the city is in mourning. And so when the church is operating in a hunger and a desire for the move of God and the Holy Ghost, God begins to work through whole nations and great and mighty things begin to take place. And when the church begins to settle and thinks everything's okay and has forgotten their mission, the world begins to fall apart. As the church goes, so goes the world. That's why you and I have to get out of here before the Antichrist can do anything. Because that idiot, and he's an idiot, can't do what he wants to do while you and I are here. Can you say amen? Amen. 2 Sundays ago, I brought Miss Nani up and had her hold her pinky up in front of the church. And I said, that pinky has more power in it than all of hell combined. And that's the absolute truth. Because if the Antichrist tried to do what he's supposed to do right now, I'd send Miss Nani over to Syria, cast the devil out of him, and the whole thing would come to naught. Can you say amen? So the reason why we have to be out of here is because we are the salt of the earth, and we are the light of the world. Now, you and I today in 2023, we don't use salt like they used to use it. Now we use salt to season our food because it's bland. But back in the day, before they had refrigerators in Bible times, they would use salt by taking, they would take foods that were perishable and they would submerge that food in salt because the salt would pull the moisture out of the food and it's the moisture that causes it to rot. So they would submerge the food in salt so that they could preserve it. Well, you are the salt of the world, or the salt of the earth. So as long as you're here, the earth is preserved. So the tribulation can't happen while you're here because you're preserving the earth. Can you say amen? Then it says you're the light of the world. Let me ask you something. Have you ever gone into a pitch black room and went to turn the light on and the darkness and the light started wrestling. Like, you turn the light on and the light's like, oh, and the darkness is like, ah, and they're like fighting each other. And the light's like, I'm trying, turn another light on. And you got to go run and get a lamp and bring that in. Well, here's another light. No. We're in an age where darkness and light are warring. No, we're not. I'm the light of the world. When I show up, darkness flees. When the light turns on, the darkness has to go. Can you say amen? And all darkness is absence of light. So if you see a dark area, it's just because there's no light there. This little light of mine. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. You're the salt of the earth. You're preserving this thing. This thing can't fall to CRAP while you're here. And you're the light of the world. Just by virtue of being a child of the Most High God, things can't fall apart. That's why I say to you, what you've probably heard Evangelist Jonathan say, that if every witch in America made it their business to curse you, nothing they did could touch you. Amen. Nothing they did could touch you. Because you can't curse what God has blessed, and I'm blessed, and you're blessed. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. That's why Jesus was sleeping on that boat when the winds and the waves were acting like weapons, targeting that boat, and Jesus was asleep. Why? Because he knew there was no possible way that I can be hindered from doing what I'm assigned to do. It's not possible. Jesus said in John chapter 10, "No man takes my life from me. I lay it down of my own accord." I have the power to lay it down, he said, and I have the power to pick it up again. But what if I told you he wasn't the only one in the Bible that exercised that power? He said, I have the power to lay it down. He said, no man takes my life from me. You know, there was this guy named Paul who said, I'm betwixt between two, whether to depart and be with the Lord or whether to remain with you, which is more needful. In other words, he said, I'm choosing whether I want to go or whether I want to stay. Before the Apostle Paul was beheaded, he said in 2 Timothy chapter 4, he said, I have run my race. I have finished my course. There is henceforth laid up for me a crown of righteousness, and not for me only, but also for all those who have loved his coming. And he said, I now pour out my life. He said, I'm pouring out my life. He didn't say, and now the Romans are going to kill me. He said, now I pour out my life as a drink offering before the Lord. The only reason that Roman soldier was ever able to drop that sword on the back of Paul's neck was because Paul realized he had run his race and finished his course. Prior to that, nobody could do anything about Paul. Because how many times did they try? Man, he was in Iconium. And the Bible says that the Jews stoned him in Iconium. And when the disciples were going to gather around him to pray, before they could even pray, he popped back up and went back into the city and kept preaching. Paul was unstoppable because that man had an understanding. There is a power in me that exceeds every power of this world, because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Can you say amen? Come on, give the Lord praise this morning. Hallelujah. So what are the true signs of the times? Are the true signs of the times that people are going to be dropping dead all over the place? Are the true signs of the times really going to be outlandishly deadly earthquakes and natural disasters? I believe that the Bible teaches different than that. Yes, there will be wars and rumors of wars. Yes, there will be earthquakes in various places and plagues that come upon the earth. But all those things happen after you and I get the heaven out of here. Now, if you want to stick around, feel free. I've got my ticket for the first bus out. Can you say amen? But I'm here to tell you today that Jesus, and I'm going to prove it to you from the Bible, Jesus is not coming back when things get bad enough. Jesus is coming back when the bride of Christ is walking in and living by the glory that was always reserved for her. Because the Bible says that he's coming back for a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but being holy before him in love. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 3 that judgment begins in the house of the Lord. I'm here to submit to you this morning. I'm here to suggest, and not really suggest, I'm kind of just telling you, that revival is that judgment. Judgment begins in the house of the Lord. That's what revival is. My pastor, who has had revivals in over 90 countries on the planet, so he knows a thing or two. He's not some Instagram guy who put revivalist in his bio and never had a revival. He hadn't even had a revival in his bathtub. He's actually had revivals. My pastor has said that revival is falling in love with Jesus all over again. It's coming back to your first love. And if you do it right, you fall in love with him again every day. Because you find out again just how wonderful he is. Revival is falling in love with Jesus all over again. The first thing that happens in revival is repentance. Well, the Bible calls that judgment. Because in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, it says, if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord so that we do not fall into the same condemnation as the world. So revival in the church is actually that judgment that first comes to the house of the Lord. It's the Spirit of God coming by his anointing and so gently and yet still so powerfully coming and judging things that need to be made right in your life. And then you lay it before God at an altar and say, God, I don't want this. And then his fire comes and burns it out. And then you feel fresh and new again. And you're happy again. Amen. My pastor said, how do I spell relief? R-E-V-I-V-A-L. Because some people are all blocked up, and that's what revival does. Is revival comes and makes you regular again. Amen. It clears you out. That's what a move of God does. And as he always says as well, it's a messy job, but somebody's got to do it. Amen. Hallelujah. That's actually what bothers people about the move of the Spirit. Because if God doesn't show up, there's been no demonstration of a standard they have to live up to. But when God shows up, now you have no choice. Now that standard's been demonstrated, and you have to come to grips with the fact that there are things that he doesn't like. Ooh. Can you say amen? That's what revival's for. And it sounds scary when you first get introduced to it, but it becomes the most beautiful thing when you start living in that place. Man, I'm telling you, I've come to the place as a child of God where I covet the Lord coming in and telling me, I want this adjusted. I want this given up. I want this change. Because the Bible says the son that he loves, he chastens. He corrects. Amen. You don't correct other people's children. You correct your own children. So if I belong to him, I need to be open to correction. Amen. Hallelujah. So the signs of the times, I'm here to tell you this morning, the signs of the times, that we are at the very cusp, the very edge of the coming of the Lord, is the church as a whole walking in the glory that has always belonged to her. Can you say amen? Go with me to Matthew chapter 16 this morning. That was a 20-minute introduction. And I would apologize, but I'm having too much fun. Praise the Lord. Matthew chapter 16 and verse 1. Say amen when you're there. The Pharisees also with the Sadducees. They were sad, you see. Religion makes you sad. The Pharisees also with the Sadducees, and as my pastor says, the wooden seas and the couldn't seas, came and tempting, desired or asked of him that he would show them a sign from heaven. He answered and said unto them, when it's nighttime, when it's evening, you say it will be fair weather tomorrow because the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be foul weather in the day because the sky is not only red, but the clouds are lowering. You hypocrites, you can discern the face of the sky, but you cannot discern the signs of the times. Evangelist Jonathan said something so powerful recently that many in the church are missing what hour it is in the body of Christ right now. It is not the hour to batten down the hatches. It is also not the hour to play little religious games. It is not the hour for church to have summer at the movies and to exegete from the Barbie movie. It is not the hour for the church to play summer at the movies and talk about how Indiana Jones is like Jesus and we're like the Temple of Doom or whatever. It's not time to play games. The moves of God are like waves of the sea. And I gave this example just a few weeks ago, but it bears repeating. That if you ever see an experienced surfer, they don't just catch whatever wave shows up just because the waters are starting to rise. They know how to discern the ocean. They know how to see when that wave that's coming is going to be a dud or whether this thing's going to be the ride of my life. And so when you see new surfers, the moment the water starts to rise, they turn their board around and start paddling. And nothing happens. And now they have to waste their energy paddling out back out. But then you see these guys who have experience, and they'll let one pass them by, and then another pass them by, and then another pass them by. But then all of a sudden, at the distance, on the horizon, a wave begins to rise. And the experienced surfer, the one who can discern that water, turns his board around and starts paddling at the right speed, at the right time, and he catches that wave. Can I tell you something? I've been asking the Lord to give me eyes to see, because there's a wave of the move of the Spirit of God. And there's been a whole lot of people that have been paddling out to things that weren't moves but looked like they might have been. But then there's people who can discern the waves of the Spirit, who are about to catch the crest of a wave the likes of which this world has never seen. And that wave is not going to be the diminishing of the church. That wave is going to be the explosion of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bishop David Oyedepo, who pastors the largest church on planet Earth, over 1 million people on Sunday. I think he knows what he's talking about. When you have 1 million people on Sunday, people should listen to you. He came to America and held a conference on the shores of this nation because he said, the Lord spoke to me and told me that the doom of the false prophets is coming to naught, and that what is really coming to America is a wave of a move of the Spirit that will birth not mega churches, super mega churches in this nation. For one reason and one reason only, because God is not mocked. And this nation has sown the gospel and revival. I feel the anointing and the move of the Holy Ghost all over the world. And it's harvest time, baby. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then Evangelist Jonathan mentioned this, that just a few years ago, his Uncle Ted, who's a prophet, said that the seeker-sensitive movement has been dangled in front of preachers like a carrot to see who would take it. And those who bought into that would miss out on what God was going to do. But for those who have stuck to the gospel, who have not compromised the move of God, what's coming to them is far greater than what that seeker-sensitive movement could have ever produced. Ladies and gentlemen, you can feel it right now in this room, by the way. The room feels electrified right now. We are on the cusp. We are on the crest of the greatest move of the Spirit this nation has ever seen. And eat your heart out, Smith Wigglesworth, Kenneth Hagin. Y'all had great moves, but we get to be here for the best one. Hallelujah. Because Jesus saves the best wine until last. Can you say amen? I have a feeling when I get to heaven, Smith Wigglesworth and Kenneth Hagin are going to say, what'd you say? Anyway, I was just preaching, you know. Anyway, so Jesus said, if you can tell that things in the natural are indications of what's to come, why can you not tell that there are indications, there are signposts in the realm of the Spirit that are trying to point to you what's coming? Because in this room right now, this room has almost packed out this morning. Some people had to leave early. But this room almost packed out this morning, full of people that came hungry for a move of God. But across this nation are empty church buildings with 15 people who think that the lack of attendance has somehow validated their view that everything's supposed to fall apart in the last hour. Are they right? No. They missed the wave. They missed the wave. They put all their apples in the religious denominational basket. But the Holy Ghost is not going to be contained through denominational boundaries and borders. The Holy Ghost is going to do what he wants through who he wants. Can you say amen? The Bible says in Isaiah 29:24 that in the last days, those who were in error concerning the things of the Spirit shall come to understanding. Those ministers that say that the gifts of the Spirit have died off, that God doesn't do those things anymore, and they're in error concerning the things of the Spirit, in this last hour of time, the move of the Holy Ghost is going to be so undeniable, they'll come to understanding. They'll say amongst themselves, have the days of the apostles returned to us? Can you say amen? And then it says in that verse that those who complained shall come to doctrine. The move of the Spirit is not undoctrinal. It's not doctrine over here and then the move of the Spirit over here. The Spirit and the Word agree. The Spirit confirms the Word. And the Word elevates the Spirit. The Bible points me to the Holy Ghost. The Bible tells me to covet the gifts of the Holy Ghost. Desire them earnestly, it says. Well, if they were going to pass away, why would the Bible tell me to desire something that I couldn't have? No, it belongs to me. Can you say amen? The move of the Holy Ghost is the portion of every believer. He that ministers the Spirit to you and works miracles among you, does he do it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? By the hearing of faith. So if the hearing of faith has not passed away, then it's not possible that miracles have passed away. If I'm still supposed to hear and receive the word by faith, then that must mean that faith still produces miracles. Because he that ministers the Spirit to you and works miracles among you does it by the hearing of faith. Faith still produces miracles. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Say the signs of the times. I want you to turn with me to an obscure verse that isn't really read too often in the Old Testament, in the book of Hosea, if you would please. Hosea chapter 6. Hosea chapter 6. And verse 1. Say amen when you're there. Hosea chapter 6 and verse 1. Come and let us return unto the Lord. For he is torn, but he will heal us. He is smitten, but he will bind us up. Listen to this, verse 2. After 2 days, he will revive us. And in the third day, he will raise us up, and we shall live in his sight. Verse 3. Then shall we know, if we follow on to know the Lord, that his going forth is prepared like the morning, and he shall come to us as the rain, as the latter and former rain unto the earth. Amen. Verse 3 tells us that the move of God is like the morning. Did any of you go to bed last night looking out the window thinking, boy, I hope the morning comes? I don't know if this is the last day and everything just ceases to be right now. I sure hope that the morning shows up. Did anybody wake up frantically at 6 this morning to look out your eastern window to make sure the sun was rising? The sun still rose. There is an assurance in you that the morning is coming. There's an assurance in you that there will be a tomorrow. The Bible says that his going forth is like the morning. In other words, you can be guaranteed God's going to move. I said you can be guaranteed that God's going to move. Amen. And the Bible says he will come to us like the rain, like the early and the latter rain upon the earth. Now, you can talk to any Bible scholar you want to, and they'll all agree that rain in the Bible is a type and shadow of the Holy Ghost and the move of the Spirit. The early rain would have represented the early church, the book of Acts, the day of Pentecost, what Paul did in Illyricum, in Iconium, what Peter did in Joppa at Cornelius' house, what Paul did in Ephesus, and all the other apostles, and the great things, the great exploits that God performed through them. That would be the early rain. Ladies and gentlemen, you and I are about to receive the latter rain. And the latter rain is always greater than the former rain. We don't have a lesser Holy Ghost. It's not like the early church got the Holy Ghost and then you and I get Holy Ghost Junior. Like, he's pretty good, you know. Like the early church got LeBron James and we all get Bronny, you know. Not quite as good as his dad, but he's, you know, he's pretty good. If you're watching, I mean it. Anyway. His coming to us will be like the rain. And as sure as the early rain has already come, you can be guaranteed we're about to see the latter rain. Somebody says, how do you know that, Pastor Michael? Because of verse 2. Verse 2 says, after 2 days, he will revive us. And in the third day, we shall live in his sight. Now, this verse is what we call, and I'm going to get a little deep on you this morning. This verse is what we call a dual reference. It is absolutely referencing Jesus coming back from the dead. Amen. It is absolutely referencing the resurrection. After 2 days, you will revive us, and in the third day, we shall live in your sight. But notice that the audience here is not a he, it's a we. We shall live in your sight. I'm here to tell you this morning that the Bible says a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as a day. Well, how many years has it been since the church started? 2,000 years. 2,000 years. The Bible says, After 2 days, you will revive us. After 2 days, you will revive us. Somebody says, Pastor Michael, what's the third day? The third day is the 1,000-year reign of Christ on the earth with his people. And that day is coming. But look at what happens after 2 days. After 2 days, you will revive us. Church, there's a revival coming. And that wave on the distance is starting to crest. It's time to turn our board around and start paddling. Hallelujah. It's time to catch that wave. Can you say amen? It's time to catch the wave of the Holy Ghost. I won't turn there because I've preached on it so many times in the past month or so. But you know that the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 2 and verse 2 that in the last days, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be exalted above the mountains and the hills, and all nations shall flow into it, and they shall say among the nations, come, let us go to the house of the Lord, that we may hear his teaching and walk in his ways. Amen. Can you say amen? Amen? The mountain of the Lord's house, that's the church. We are the latter temple. The Bible says that the glory of the latter house shall be greater than the glory of the former. And in the last days, the mountain of the Lord's house, that's you. The church of the Lord Jesus Christ. You are the dwelling place of the Holy Ghost, and the Spirit of God lives on the inside of you. Can you say amen? Amen. So when does that, the Bible guarantee us that the mountain of the Lord's house will be exalted so mightily that the multitudes of the nations... That doesn't sound like a diminishing church to me. That doesn't sound like church attendance going down. That doesn't sound like people not really being interested in the gospel anymore. That sounds like a move of God that's going to sweep every nation of the earth. Can you say amen? Amen. It's amazing because, you know, there's an old saying that they say, statistics never lie and liars use statistics. Because statistics only reflect, you can adjust them, you can manipulate them to say whatever you want them to say. So if you go on CNN or MSNBC and you look up church attendance in America, they're going to post graphs that make it look like church attendance in America is on the decline. But here's what they don't tell you. The only churches that they poll about attendance are denominational churches. Denominations are on the decline. Nobody has ever called me and asked me if my church attendance is going up. I've never gotten a call from CNN or MSNBC. What's your church attendance looking like? They say that conversion to Christianity is on the decline. Nobody called me last Monday and say, how many people came to the altar at the back to school outreach? So they just, in order to get their graph to look the way they want it to discourage the Christian from having the boldness to step out into the ministry of reconciliation that they're called to, they just ask the right people so that their graph can look like the church in a little wiggly line is on the decline. But I'm here to tell you that Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Jesus is still building and there's still not anything the devil can do about it. Can you say amen? Come on, give the Lord praise in this place this morning. So what's the sign of the times? How do we know we're almost there? It is not because of earthquakes and natural disasters and plagues and economic downfall. That's not the sign. That's the sign the devil wants you looking at. Because it paralyzes you from doing what God has called you to do. But the true signs of the times are the clouds of the latter rain beginning to gather above us. That the fact the Bible says after 2 days he will revive us. That the church is starting to step over into her glory. Can you say amen? That signs and wonders and miracles are becoming more prevalent than ever before. I don't agree with everybody. There's plenty of people I don't agree with on plenty of things. But I'm grateful that the move of God is being talked about more than it's ever been talked about before. And the church is starting to get it in their spirits once again that God's not interested in some mediocre little thing. He's interested in shaking whole cities, whole regions, whole nations by his power. Can you say amen? And you're going to be a part of that move. What are the true signs of the times? The move of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And we're entering into that move right now. We're entering into that move right now. We're entering into that time right now. If I were you, I wouldn't back off of miracles. I'd press in like never before. Hallelujah. Will you turn one more place with me? James chapter 5. And then I'll pray. I think. James. Hallelujah. James chapter 5. Now, before we read this passage, Zechariah chapter 10. Ask of the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain. Here's what you need to know today. There are some prayers that it doesn't matter when you ask them. What you're asking for belongs to you. Healing belongs to you no matter what. So you can ask for it at any time. Lord, healing is the children's bread. I'll have a bite of bread this morning, please. Amen. Hallelujah. Provision, it's part of your covenant. You can ask for it at any time. There are some prayers, the answer is yours no matter when you ask. But then there are certain things that the Spirit of God stirs up at certain times to get his people to ask for because it's time for that thing. Brother Hagin tells the testimony that before the great healing revival of the 40s and 50s, in the late 30s, at the close of World War Number Two, he said he would be praying in the Spirit, and then he would find himself praying in his understanding, Lord, send a revival of divine healing to America. Lord, send a revival of divine healing to America. And then, of course, the great healing revival of the 40s and the 50s hit with the ministry of Oral Roberts and A.A. Allen and T.L. Osborne and Jack Coe and all of these, and Catherine Coleman and all of these great men and women of God that God used. Brother Hagin said in the healing revival of the 40s and 50s, he said it was the easiest thing in the world to get people healed. He said people would get healed on accident. Because that was what was in the air. That's what was moving. And it's not that God wouldn't have healed anybody at any other time. But God had re-stirred that message in the church. That was the wave that was cresting at that moment. And certain ministers caught that wave. And Brother Hagin said he would be in the green room with other ministers during the healing revival. And he would tell them, you know what's funny is at the close of World War Number Two, towards the end of the 1930s, I would feel in my spirit to start praying for a revival of divine healing in America. And he said without fail, no matter where he said that, the ministers in the green room would say, I was praying that too. I was praying that exact same thing. Because it was time to start asking for that. Well, the Bible says in Zechariah chapter 10, ask the Lord for rain in the time of the latter rain. There are certain requests where there's the right time to ask for it. And I'm here to tell you this morning, the time to ask for the latter rain is right now. Ask ye of the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain, so shall he send bright clouds. What makes a cloud bright? Lightning. Lightning. No, clouds darken the sun. It makes the room dark. Amen. It's talking about lightning. Lightning is a display of what? Power. So shall he send bright clouds. He'll send power. Bright clouds and grass to every man's field. Can you say amen? It's the time of power. It's the time of the latter rain. It's the time to ask. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. James chapter 5. Have you found it? James chapter 5. Hallelujah. Verse 7. Be patient, therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman. Who's the husbandman? Jesus. Jesus is the husbandman. Behold, the husbandman waits for the precious fruit of the earth. What's the precious fruit of the earth? Us, souls, people. Behold, the husbandman waits for the precious fruit of the earth and has long patience for it. Until what? Until he received the early and the latter rain. The fullness of the Gentiles, the fullness of the nations, the fullness of the harvest of souls is not going to come in until the latter rain, which is what we're stepping into right now. It's that hour. It's that moment right now. Can you see the signs of the times? Man, this is not time to play religious games. That's why I preached on, out of Haggai, just a couple Sundays ago, where Haggai rebukes the children of Israel and he says, is it time for you to dwell in paneled houses while my house lies in ruins? You have to understand that God has a time clock. God has a prophetic calendar. And wherever he has chosen to place you on that calendar, you have a role to play to see his will brought to pass on the earth. You are not here for no reason. You are not an accident. You didn't happen to just be born right now. The Almighty God, from before the beginning of time, chose to have you here and now. The Bible says God has pre-appointed your times and your places of dwelling in the hopes that you would seek him. Because when you begin to seek him, you find out what he has you here for. You find out God doesn't just have me here to live and breathe and die. You find out God doesn't just have me here to work 9 to 5 until I can retire. You find out God doesn't want your life summarized by a dash mark in between a birth date and a death date on your tombstone. But God has something great reserved for you. And then if you feel like you've wasted time, I have good news. When you seek the Lord, you find out that God redeems the time. And whatever time you feel you've wasted, he can make up for it in just a matter of days. God can do in 1 year what man could never do in a lifetime. Can you say amen? I'm fully persuaded that God wanted Smith Wigglesworth in the ministry far earlier than 56. But that British plumber was a little hard-headed and didn't get the message. It didn't get through till he was 56. But that's all right. God gave him 30 years of one of the most miraculous ministries in church history that to this day, 100 years later, we're still talking about how God used him to raise the dead, how God used him to cause tumors to fall off of people's bodies, the fire of God to set people free. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. But if you don't discern the signs of the times, and if the devil can distract you to look at the wrong signs, you'll get off the highway too soon. You were looking at the wrong signs. Oh, another earthquake. Yeah, there's going to be earthquakes. Because all of creation groans and travails, waiting, not waiting for everything to fall apart, waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. The reason the earth is groaning and travailing is because it's waiting for you and I to step up into the glory that God has reserved for us. Ephesians chapter 5. Are you getting something out of this morning? Y'all are locked in with me. I'm loving it. Ephesians chapter 5. I quoted it earlier. I'm going to quote it one more time, and I'm going to give some clarity on something. Ephesians chapter 5, that Jesus is coming back for a glorious bride, not having spot or wrinkle or blemish or any such thing, but being holy before him in love. Say spot. Wrinkle, blemish. We have to define those things. Because if you just try to pick something out of the air to say, oh, that's what a spot or a blemish is, and you don't define it biblically, you're going to misunderstand what it's saying. Because I've heard people say, oh, no, we're already, you know, where we're supposed to be, because when we were born again, our spots and blemishes were wiped away. How does the Bible define a spot and blemish? It's not just talking about just sin. It's not just talking about that. 2 Peter chapter 2 and the book of Jude both say this. They say that false teaching is a spot and a blemish amongst your fellowships. So when the Bible says that Jesus is coming back for a glorious church, not having spot or blemish, it's saying he's coming back for a glorious church that doesn't give any room to false teaching. Amen. That in this revival that's going to begin in the church and then become an awakening that reaches out to the nations outside of us, in this revival, in this move of God, God is going to burn out, weed out false teaching. Because there's spots and there are blemishes in our fellowships. It's the number one thing that the New Testament warns against is false teaching. Paul told the Ephesian church, he said, I am persuaded that after I go, wolves shall rise up among you, drawing disciples away to themselves. Can you say amen? He told him, he said, I'm leaving, and because I was your protection from false teaching, the devil's already got a plan. The moment I go, wolves are going to rise up. You need to watch for them. That's one of the reasons, I know you guys probably think I just mention it because I'm on Instagram too much, but one of the reasons why I mention these little things that I hear on the internet is because I realize that I have two services with you, just a couple of hours each, and the rest of the time during the week, you have all kinds of voices coming in telling you stuff. And so I have to address those pertinent voices. It's my job as a shepherd. I have to address those pertinent voices to help you be able to discern what you should be listening to and what you shouldn't. That's my job. I wish I could follow you everywhere. You probably don't wish I could follow you, but I wish. Some of y'all were like, oh God. My wife just said she didn't want that. So, I mean, but I wish I could be with you 24/7, and when you scroll on Instagram and some nonsense comes up, I can say, ah, that's nonsense. Oh, okay, but I can't do that. Thankfully, the Holy Ghost is with you everywhere you go. But we've been talking about this on Wednesdays, the leading of the Lord, the conscience works through understanding. Amen. So your spirit's going to speak up based on what you've heard. So I have to address these things. But I'm here to let you know that the Spirit of God is working overtime in the church right now to weed out nonsense, the spots and blemishes of false teaching. So that, because why? Because he wants his church to be a glorious church. Now, he said not having spot or blemish, but what was the third thing? Wrinkle. Where do wrinkles come from? You've been sitting here for 3 hours. Some of y'all are shifting cheeks back and forth. But no matter who you are or what material your clothing is made of, because I take so long, when you get up out of your chair this morning, the back of your shirt's going to have a wrinkle on it. Because it's a combination of inactivity and pressure. The enemy wants to pressure the church into doing nothing. But the more you get up and start walking around, you do it long enough, the wrinkles fall out. And so in the last hour of time, we're going to have an active church. There won't be any time and there won't be any pressure for wrinkles to accumulate. And so our garments will not only be purified from spots and blemishes, but the wrinkles will fall out. Because we'll be about our Father's business in the ministry of reconciliation, bringing in the harvest of souls that the husbandman has been waiting for. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. The signs of the times is not things falling apart. The signs of the times is the church rising up and being used by God the way God's always intended. Do you believe that this morning? Amen. Come on, give the Lord praise in this place. Hallelujah. Come on, give God a shout today. Hallelujah. Now I want to do two things this morning. If I can get Mr. Kenny on the keys, I'd appreciate it. Hallelujah. I want to do two things this morning. First was a promise. If I can have Colleen come up here, please. Hallelujah. I know, terrible timing, I'm sorry. If you just sit right here for me. I want you to stretch your hands out toward her. I know you couldn't tell during praise and worship, but the doctor told her she broke her ankle. And she's been walking on it no problem, but she said there's been pain, but God's going to take that pain right out. Amen. Well, what a woman of faith. She didn't even put a cast on. She was dancing around. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Yeah, go ahead, buddy. That's your mom. Hallelujah. Stretch your hands out toward her. And which foot is it? This one. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. By the authority of the name of Jesus, the bone that is fractured and the pain that's come with it, I command this bone to mend now in Jesus' name. And I command all pain, go! Go from her now in the mighty name of Jesus. May it be, Father, that she walk without any issue whatsoever, not even a remembrance of it. In Jesus' name, total healing. That not only would the pain go, but when she goes for a checkup, there's not even a trace that there was ever a crack or a break or a fracture of any sort. In Jesus' name. Your word declares, Father, you shall decree a thing and it shall be established unto you. We decree healing now in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for it. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Come on, give the Lord praise this morning. Hallelujah. 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 Would you bow your heads all over this place this morning? Please don't leave. Service is almost over. This is the most important part today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. With every head bowed today and every eye closed, I want to give an invitation. I don't know who you are. I don't know where you came from. I know very little about every person in this room. But one thing I know is that no matter who you are, Jesus loves you. Jesus, the Son of the living God, stepped down from his throne in heaven and put on the vesture of human flesh to come to this earth and die for you. So, my friend, I want to ask you a question today. Has there ever been a time in your life where you have publicly repented of sin and confessed Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Listen, I'm not asking, have you ever been to church before? I'm not asking, have you ever prayed before? I'm not asking if you've gone through any sort of religious ritual. I'm asking, have you ever surrendered your life to Jesus? Have you ever believed with your heart and confessed with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and that God raised him from the dead? That's all it takes. Somebody says, how could it be that simple? Because Jesus did the hard part. Jesus was whipped. He was beaten. He was bruised for our iniquities. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was chastised for our peace. And because Jesus did what we couldn't do, all there's left for us to do is to call upon the name of the Lord. And whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's that simple. Jesus loves you today. If you've never received the Lord Jesus, don't leave this place today without knowing that you've been made right with God, that you have peace with God. Hallelujah. Maybe you're in this place today, and at one time you did surrender your life to the Lord. But if you were honest, you're not serving God like you should today. It's not that you don't love him, but life's gotten in the way. You've gotten so busy that God's been put on the back burner. But you know that Jesus gave his all for you, and that he calls for you to give your all to him. If you're here today and you say, Pastor, I've surrendered my life to the Lord before, but I'm not serving God like I should. My friend, I have good news for you. God's not angry with you. He loves you. And he's calling you back into fellowship with him today. Maybe it was because something came in and it rocked your world and knocked you off your feet. Maybe it was a bankruptcy or the loss of a loved one or the betrayal of a close friend or the loss of a job. Something happened and it knocked you off course. You were never quite able to recover. But today you hear God's call and you say, I want to come home. I want you to know He loves you. That call is Him. And if He's calling you, He won't reject you when you come to Him. Maybe you're in this place today and you love the Lord. You do your best to serve Him. But the devil's always lying to you, telling you you're not saved. He tells you you've done too much wrong, that God can't forgive somebody like you. I want you to know that's a lie from the pit of hell. There is nothing you've done that the blood of Jesus cannot wash away completely. And today, you and I can pray together, and you can know that you know. On the inside, in your spirit, you'll know, I'm a child of God. You need to have that knowing. The Bible calls it the inward witness. You need to have that. So if you're in this place today and you fit in any one of those three categories, number one, you've never received the Lord Jesus, you've never surrendered your life to Him, and today you know you need to do so. Number two, you once surrendered to Him, but you're not serving Him like you should, and you want to come back into fellowship with Him. Or number three, you love the Lord, but the devil's always lying to you, telling you you're not saved, and today you want to be sure. If you're in this place today and you fit in any one of those three categories, I want to pray with you and for you. I'm going to ask you in just a moment to do something very bold, but very simple. I'm going to ask you in just a moment, when I count to three, to forget about everybody else in this room. This has nothing to do with any other person in this room but you and Jesus. And on the count of three, I'm going to ask you to get up out of your seat and come to the front where I am. We're calling this an altar. And today we're going to do business with God. If you mean business with God, God means business with you. He loves you. And so on the count of three, if that's you, make that bold decision. Don't let anything stop you. Today is your day. On the count of three, don't hesitate. When I say three, jump up out of your seat and come up here. Get ready. One. Don't wait. Don't hesitate. This is your moment right now. Two. Get ready. Three. If that's you, come up out of your seat and come right now. We're going to pray together. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Hallelujah. Come on, come on, come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. 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 If you know that's you, we're waiting for you. Don't miss it. This is your moment right now. Come on, come on, come on. Hallelujah. Jesus loves you. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm not trying to drag it out, but I'm going to give it one more moment. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. It's not about being a member of a church. It's about being a citizen of heaven. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. You're the best in the biz, I'm telling you. You're awesome. I love you. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. I want you to look up at me. For what it's worth, I'm proud of you for coming up here. I love you very much. And more than me, Jesus loves you very much. Now, I have some good news. Jesus said, no one can come to me unless the Father draw him. And he said, those who come to me, I will not cast out. So the fact that you're up here is proof that God drew you, because you know you wouldn't have come on your own. And if God drew you, God's not schizophrenic. He's not going to draw you up here and then change his mind. So that's how we know when we pray together right now that the answer is already yes. And when we pray together right now, God's presence is going to come over you. You're going to feel it physically. And it's going to be a sign to you that God's doing the work on the inside. He's a good God. Amen. Now, normally I'd have you pray for yourselves, but I want to make sure we hit all the high points. So I want you to lift your hands to heaven, if you would. And we're going to say this prayer together. I want you to repeat after me. Mean it with all your heart. Say it loud enough so the devil knows he's lost you for good. And let me get the help of the congregation this morning. Say this with me. Say, Heavenly Father, I come to you in the precious name of your Son, Jesus. Lord, you said in your word, I must believe with my heart and confess with my mouth, and I would be saved. So, Father, right now, I believe and confess Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He came in the flesh. He lived a sinless life. He died on the cross for me. And on the third day, you raised him from the dead. One day soon, he's coming back for me. Because today, I surrender my whole life to you. Father, forgive me of all my sin. Wash me, cleanse me, set me free. Let me never be the same again. Today, I'm born again. Today, I'm forgiven. My past is behind me, and I walk with Jesus from this day forward. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, give the Lord praise in this place. Hallelujah. 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 Now, God's already touching you. I want to just pray for you. You don't have to repeat this part, but just lift your hands and let me pray over you. Lift your hands one more time. Father, seal this precious group of people by your blood and by your spirit. Root out everything that's not of you. No more struggle. No more struggle. Only freedom. Only freedom. That's it. Filled in Jesus' name. There it is. In Jesus' name. Let them never be the same again. Father, let even the bodily effects of the past be undone. That the only proof anything ever happened would be the testimony of his mouth of what Jesus has done. Thank you, Father, for your power touching him from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. That's it, my friend. Jesus. That's it. Jesus. There it is. Never the same. That's it. Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Never the same. Jesus. Wonderful. The past is over. All things are made new. Jesus. There it is. All things are made new. This mighty man of God, Lord, you're going to use him to touch his generation. You love him very much. That's it. Jesus. Right through you. Let that go right through you. Jesus. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Father, let him see himself the way you see him. In Jesus' name. Let him see clearly how much you love him. That you don't see him like other people have seen him and criticized and accused. That you see him as the finished product, being everything you've called him to be. I thank you, Lord, for it. Jesus. Never the same. Never the same. That's it, my friend. They go right through you. Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus loves you so much. Thank you, Lord. Come on, give the Lord praise in this place today. Hallelujah. 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 Well, say this with me. Say, I have eyes to see the signs of the times. And the sign is the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Before you go today, I want you to know you are mighty. You are strong in your generation. And the great dreams, the great things you've seen on the inside, they're not there by accident. God is going to bring them to pass. You believe that? Amen. Jump up on your feet with me this morning. Let me lead you in a confession of blessing before you go today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Say this with me today. Say, I'm blessed. My house is blessed. My family's blessed. My spouse is blessed. My children are blessed. My place of employment is blessed. My business is blessed. My church is blessed. My city is blessed. My state is blessed. My nation is blessed. Everywhere that I go and everything that I do is blessed. I'm empowered by God to be fruitful, to multiply, to replenish the earth, to take dominion over it and subdue it, that I may establish God's covenant in all the earth, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We love you very, very much. Glory to God. Te amo. Besitos. Enchiladas.